ladies and gentlemen. My name is Michael Lahr. I'm Program Director of Elysium Between Two Continents, and it's wonderful that Catherine Lau initiated this coming of Elysium to Vancouver. I'm very thankful for that, that we are able to present these three evenings of Victor Ullmann's music here. Let me give you a little bit of background information about the circumstances under which the music you will hear shortly was created. Music and ghetto, music and concentration camp, that seems to be an incompatible contrast. And yet, there were many musical activities in a number of camps and ghettos. An entire symphony orchestra under Shimon Pullman frequently gave concerts in the Warsaw ghetto. In the Vilna ghetto, the Jewish Council still organized a musical competition in 1943. Many folk songs were created in ghettos and camps, very often based on Yiddish texts. One song which quickly spread far beyond its place of origin is the so-called Moorsoldatenlied, based on a text by Johann Esser, poet of the working class, and a melody by Udi Guguel. It emerged from the concentration camp Bürgermoor, but was made famous through Hans Eisler and Ernst Busch during their exile in London. In this context, also the Women's Orchestra in Auschwitz has to be mentioned, led by Alma Rosé, a niece of Gustav Mahler. In the infamous extermination machinery of the Nazi regime, Theresienstadt, or Terezin, plays a very special role. It was, as you all might know, a propaganda instrument to distract the world from the final solution. It was, as Lucy Davidovits called it, the blonde lie to disguise the black lie. It was to serve as a model ghetto to make the world believe that the resettlement of Jews and their transport to so-called work deployments in the East was exactly that, not their way into annihilation. Especially prominent Jews and highly decorated Jewish veterans from World War I were brought to Theresienstadt. A special feature of the musical activities in Theresienstadt was the fact that they were used for propaganda. A second special quality of musical life in Terezin is the high concentration of first-class artists. Karel Anschal was one of them. He survived and later became the first conductor of the Czech Philharmonic after World War II. Then there is the pianist Juliette Arani, the bass Karel Behrmann, the conductors Robert Brock and Peter Deutsch, the tenor David Grünfeld, the pianist Alice Herz-Sommer. She just passed away last February at the age of 110 in London and was the honorary artistic director of Elysium until her death. The violinists Pavel Kling and Egon Ledig, the harpist Susanna Musichkova, the conductor and pianist Raphael Schächter, the pianist Edith Steiner-Kraus, and, of course, the composers Gideon Klein, Pavel Haas, Hans Krasser, Sigmund Schuhn, and Victor Ullmann. Because of the incredible concentration and quality of musicians, and because of the propagandistic use of Terezin, we have a third special feature, and that is the extraordinary number of musical presentations in Theresienstadt. Numerous chamber music concerts were given, piano and song recitals. There was even a studio for new music. The conductor Karl Fischer presented Haydn's Oratorio Die Schöpfung and Mendelssohn's Elijah, and Raphael Schächter prepared the presentation of Verdi's Requiem. A choice which was highly disputed since, after all, it involved playing a Roman Catholic Mass for the dead in a Jewish camp. But Josa Karas, who wrote in his book Music in Terezin, argues that the majority of Czech and German Jews were assimilated to a point that they celebrated Christmas and Easter. And so the Verdi Requiem simply was an integral part of the European musical tradition with which the inmates of Terezin had grown up. They considered themselves to be the heirs of this tradition in the same way as their oppressors did. Three times Raphael Schächter had to start to put this presentation together. Almost his entire chorus was wiped out twice after just one performance because of transports to the east. But he did not give up and organized a third chorus, and still with the same soloists was able to present 15 performances. One of those performances was a concert for the Committee of the International Red Cross that had urged the Nazis to visit one of the camps, and they were led to Theresienstadt. And this concert was hosted by Adolf Eichmann. It may seem like a sad irony of history that the condemned sang the song of death for themselves and their brothers and sisters while their hangmen were sitting in the first row. But with Josa Karas, one can also interpret this performance as Schächter's last demonstration of defiance and not buckling under. The condemned sang the Requiem for their condemners and their doomed Third Reich. From this, the question arises as to which role music played for the prisoners of Theresienstadt. And I would like to quote a survivor, the ghetto inmate Thomas Mandl. He wrote, "Already the mere decision to be culturally active was rebellion. Rebellion against the National Socialist dictum that Jews are subhuman creatures and thus incapable of any real culture. Culture also meant rebellion against the indescribable material misery, starting with the permanent hunger which threatened to dominate the entire psychological and emotional life of the ghetto inmates, to the wicked physical and psychological burden of the disgraceful accommodations in mass quarters, to the, so to speak, metaphysical horror of the transports, whose destination no one knew, but which were experienced as death threats nonetheless. Thus, even a reading of antique authors in their original language was a political fact." End of quote. Cultural activity served to ease the inmates' heavy burden, to strengthen their courage to face life. It served education, which the inmates did not want to have taken away even under the most horrible circumstances. It served to preserve the human dignity of the camp prisoners. In this respect, music in Theresien is a magnificent testimony to the human spirit which prevailed even under the most horrific circumstances. This leads to another point, namely the topic of death in the works of Victor Ullmann. The death theme can be heard at first as a foreboding in his earliest songs written in Theresien. More directly, Ullmann points at it in The Dance of Death and in the second of the three Chinese songs called Der müde Soldat, The Weary Soldier, which reads, "I am skewered by a thousand knives and weary, weary of too much death." Finally, it becomes the central theme in Ullmann's opera The Emperor of Atlantis, or Death Abdicates. And that's exactly what the opera is about. Death refuses to be of service when the megalomaniac Emperor of Atlantis overall proclaims absolute war. Suddenly, no one can die anymore. The wounded on the battlefield can't die, the enemies can't die, and the logic of the ruler, which is based on his power over the life and death of his subjects, falls apart. Enemies recognize each other as human beings again. There's a beautiful love encounter across trenches and fronts, and in the end, death is willing to resume his task if the Emperor of Atlantis is ready to follow him as the first one. After a big philosophical farewell aria, the emperor is willing to do this. Now, was this wishful thinking on the part of the librettist Peter Keen and the composer Victor Ullmann? The idea that the dictator, Hitler, would realize his human powerlessness and give in? The hope that the Nazi regime would soon be finished? In any case, Ullmann's opera can clearly be interpreted as a comment on the actual Nazi regime. But particularly interesting is how the figure of death has changed. The grim reaper that he was in former days is by the end of the opera a benign gardener. a liberator and comforter who says of himself, I am the one who will free you from the plague. I am not the plague itself. I bring you release from suffering. I am not the one who lets you suffer. Death also is at the center of two other works which Ullmann began in 1944. First, his opera Jeanne d'Arc, for which he wrote the libretto and sketched rudiments of the music, and then the Cornet, which you will be hearing later. Both works end with the death of their protagonists. But what remains, even beyond death, what survives is the idea. While Ullmann tried in his opera The Emperor of Atlantis to give back to death human features against the background of the sheer madness and senselessness of concentration camps, death has lost all its terror in these two very late works. The German musicologist Ingo Schulz assumes that three incidents have substantially influenced the composition of the cornet. First, the death of the young composer Sigmund Schul in Theresienstadt on June 2, 1944, with whom Ullmann had a close friendship. And then there were two news items which spread through the information network of the ghetto like wildfire. The landing of the Allies in Normandy on June 6 and the beginning of the major Soviet offensive against the German army on June 22nd. Both news were greeted with a certain euphoria and reinforced the hope of a swift end of liberation. Under these impressions, Ullmann wrote his cornet in the late summer of 1944 in just 3 weeks. It's remarkable that he chose the cornet, a poem by Rainer Maria Rilke, which thousands of German and Austrian soldiers had in their knapsacks during World War I, and Ullmann was one of them. How can we interpret the fact that he picked such a military topic? First, I think he wanted to demonstrate that he regarded himself as standing in the same line of tradition as his Nazi guards. He did not want his oppressors to prohibit him from dealing with subjects which they regarded as their privilege. Second, one can understand the cornet as a declaration of war against the National Socialist enemy. Viewed as such, it should encourage the inmates to fight, as it had encouraged German and Austrian soldiers during World War I. It's not important that the cornet dies, important is that the battle is won. Ullmann wrote an essay at the same time when he was composing the cornet, and he titled this essay Goethe and Ghetto. And I think this essay helps us to think through his concept of death. He writes, I quote, "Thus Goethe's maxim, live in the moment, live in eternity, has always revealed to me the enigmatic meaning of art. Painting preserves, like in a still life, the ephemeral, the transitory thing or the quickly fading flower, as well as landscape, the human face and form, or the important historical moment of the past. Music accomplishes the same for everything concerning the soul, for the emotions and passions of human beings. The form, as Goethe and Schiller understand it, functions as that which overcomes matter." And now comes this incredible sentence, "Theresienstadt was and is for me the school of form." End of quote. The artist basically is the one who overcomes death. The composer is the one who conquers death by giving a higher spiritual form to mere matter, by creating something which lasts even beyond his own death. In the same essay, Ullmann said, "It must be emphasized that by no means did we sit weeping at the rivers of Babylon, and that our cultural will was equal to our will to live." This sentence summarizes the extent of Ullmann's creativity and the moral greatness of his life in the face of desperation and death. Yesterday, 71 years ago, on October 16, 1944, Ullmann was deported from Terezin to Auschwitz, and 2 days later, upon his arrival, killed in the gas chambers. But before he was sent on this transport, he entrusted his friend Emil Utitz with the scores of music that he had written in Theresienstadt, and thus the music survived, and it's still a wonderful testimony today to Ullmann's creativity and his wonderful humanitarian spirit. Thank you.
Weise von Liebe und Tod des Cornets Christoph Rilke. Den 24. November 1663 wurde Otto von Rilke auf Langenau, Grenitz und Ziegera zu Linder mit seinem ungarn gefallenen Bruders Christoph hinterlassenem Anteil am Gute Linder begeben. Doch musste er ein Gewehr ausstellen, nach welchem die Lehensreichung null und nichtig sein sollte, im Falle sein Bruder Christoph, der nach beigebrachten Totenschein als Kornett in der Kompanie des Freiherrn von Sirovano verstorben war, zurückkehrt. Reiten, reiten, reiten. Durch den Tag, durch die Nacht, durch den Tag. Reiten, reiten, reiten. Der Mut ist so müde geworden und die Sehnsucht so groß. Es gibt keine Berge mehr, kaum einen Baum. Nichts wagt aufzustehen. Fremde Witten hocken durstig an versumpften Brunnen. Nirgends ein Turm und immer das gleiche Bild. Man hat zwei Augen zu viel. Nur in der Nacht manchmal glaubt man, den Weg zu kennen. Vielleicht kehren wir nächtens in der fremden Sonne mühsam gewonnen haben. Was ich gehört. Wenn es Deutsch nicht kann, in den Haufen. Der versteht es auf einmal. Fühlt einzelne Worte.
Thank you.
Feind ist nah.
Wirre Lieder klirrten aus Glanz und Glanz. Und endlich
dich aus den reif gewordenen Takten entsprang der Tanz und alle Risse hing. Das war ein Wellenschlag in den Seelen, als ich begegnete und als ich erwähnte, ein Abschied nehmen und ein Wiederfinden. Glanz genießen und ein Licht erblicken und ein sich wiegen in den Sommerwinden, die in den warmen Kleidern frauten.
Thank you.
dunkel. Aber sie leuchten sich ins Gesicht mit ihrem Lächeln. Sie tasten vor sich her und blenden und finden den anderen wie eine Tür. Fast wie Kinder, die sich vor der Angst ängstigen, drängen sich ineinander ein und doch fürchten sie sich nicht. Da ist nichts, was gegen sie wäre. Kein Gestern, kein Morgen, denn die Zeit ist eingestürzt.
Alle fern voran und erkennen den
und erkennen die Falle, aber er fängt sie zu schlagen an, wirft sich hinaus und wird groß und rot. Da brennt ihre Fahne mit den Feinden und sie jagen ihr nach. Thank you.